2012. First, I'd like to welcome Solomon Goldstein Rose, who was elected the other night to the Amherst School Committee. Welcome, Solomon.
Thank you.
Good to have you here. And Zoe Langsdale, who is the representative from the Student Advisory Council. Is that the right name? Okay. Great. At the high school. So good to have you too, Zoe.
Welcome.
The other thing pretty neat tonight is that we were live on TV tonight from the library for the first time, so we're really happy that Jerry and his gang were able to get that hooked up. So hopefully we can have meetings here from now on. We'll see how it goes tonight.
And we should thank Amherst Media with that as well,
because
it was a collaboration between Amherst Media and the schools.
Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, agenda review. Any questions or comments on the agenda? Okay, moving on. Approval of minutes of January 17th and January 24th. Any comments, corrections on those?
Motion on both?
Sure.
Move on both, please. Accept.
Is there a second?
Second.
Yep. That was a motion to approve both minutes. Who seconded? Catherine. Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? All right. Minutes are approved. Announcement of public comment. Is there anyone to make a public comment tonight? Any announcements from the committee? Yes, Kristen.
I don't know if Maria's going to mention this, but just to acknowledge that there's going to be an additional forum that the Schutzberry and Leverett School Committees are holding to discuss the potential change in time on February 15th. So just another option.
And that's 7 o'clock in Schutzberry Elementary School.
Mm-hmm. At the library in Schutzberry.
Okay, great.
Schutzberry Elementary.
Great. Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, superintendent's update.
Okay, great. Pass these out. Did you need one for your reference? Okay. So first, I just, again, would like to say it's great to see that we have a new member, and it's great to have the student perspective represented. And Zoe, having a representative back is really important. We missed not having one for that period of time, so we're thrilled to have you here. And again, Solomon and Zoe, this is new, so if there are questions that you have, you can ask the chair for clarification as meetings go on if you're not really sure how to, to respond. So rely on the chair. He'll help you out. So I wanted to make a few announcements tonight. One, I'm not sure that I announced publicly prior. We've been working for a while on bringing Dr. Ron Ferguson to Amherst. And for people who are not aware of Dr. Ferguson's work, he's a lecturer in education and policy, public policy at Harvard Graduate School of Education and at the Harvard Kennedy School. And he is a nationally renowned educator whose research and writing is primarily focused on racial achievement gaps. And many of our staff have had the opportunity to see Dr. Ferguson speak over a number of years and have found his work to be really valuable, meaningful, and transferable to concrete action steps, which is critically important for us. So we will be having him come in March. We're still confirming the date at this moment, but we're thinking of the last Wednesday in March, and we'll have an opportunity for Dr. Ferguson to meet with the leadership team, to meet with our partnership group, because the five colleges are supporting with other community members supporting Dr. Ferguson coming, so supporting financially as well as offering opportunities for him to places to speak and such. And then we will also have an opportunity for staff to hear Dr. Ferguson, and then an evening event as well, so open to the community. So we expect that will be a free event, and we'd love to see students, staff, and community members join us. So exciting work. Also, again, just to mention that the MSAN student conference will be coming, and I think we've confirmed the last week of September, I think is what we're working on at the moment. which will be Wednesday through Saturday for our students, but also for students in the MCM districts across the country to come and join us in Amherst. And again, the five colleges in the community are stepping up to partner with us to bring the students here. So we'll be having support from the local colleges and universities, use of space and such, to support us bringing this amazing opportunity to Amherst. We also are working closely with Amherst Education Foundation, who has provided a substantial amount of financial support to our schools over the years in it, Leverett, Shutesbury, Pelham, and Amherst in the regional schools. And we've kind of started to work together probably over the past 6 months to think about how to kick off an alumni giving campaign. So Kim Stender has been working on updating the directory, which is an alumni directory that we were able to take care of, and also work with AEF to think about a kickoff in November, because that's when a lot of people come home for reunions. So we are hoping to have a musical event that we could ask alumni to come back and perform as a community kickoff, which would be a free event, but that would kick off the alumni giving efforts. So, and again, hope to bring resources into our schools. Sixth grade has historically attended the high school musical, and our sixth grade classes are coming to see Guys and Dolls on 9:30 on Wednesday, February 29th. Before public appearances happen. And I know in Pelham, we just mentioned that the sixth graders are very excited to come and see the performance. Zoe, are you in the performance? Excellent. And we would strongly encourage school committee members to come and see the performance. And I will make sure that I am there myself with my daughter. Also, as Kristen mentioned, we have upcoming forum for Leverett and Shutesbury and open to other community members to attend to share their feedback. At this time, we have had three forums that have had 68 parents, guardians, students, community members attend and provide their input, but also add questions and or concerns. So we're in the process over the next several days to analyze that feedback and to consider next steps. In the meantime, and I think Mike might want to say something about this, in the meantime, if people have specific, if they weren't able to attend and they want to send something, they can send it in to Debbie Westmoreland, which is westmorelandd@arps.org, and she'll compile that additional information. So did you want to share something, too?
One additional item I forgot to email. You guys will let the school committee know is that we're having the MCN students came and presented to you about their action plans we've done and the shadow day. So this coming Wednesday, we have 26 seventh graders that are going to go shadow at the high school, and part of it's going to be experience a couple different things, but also have a conversation, as we've talked about kind of the things that happen in seventh grade and the way that affects, you know, affects their feeling in terms of what I wish I knew then. So I just want to let you guys know, because you've heard that before, that will be happening. And thanks to Mary Custard at the high school, Tom Sidney at the middle school, for working on getting, identifying all those kids, and that will be happening.
Thanks, Mike. Two other things I just wanted to mention that to the committee, that we're presenting to the finance committee tomorrow night at 8 o'clock, the Amherst and regional budgets. So if members want to come, you know, obviously we would love to have you there. Rob and I will be there. But if there's an interest, I know there's a lot of nights out this week, but including the four-town meeting on Saturday. But just so that people know, that is happening. We're slated for, we think, 8 o'clock on Thursday. And there's also a BCG meeting tomorrow in Amherst, tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That's it for me.
Any questions on the superintendent update? Okay, moving along. Fiscal year 13 budget update.
Okay, so Rob, you want to come up and help out with walking us through the new our new understanding around budget support coming from the state, Chapter 70. So Rob's going to walk us through where we are at the moment, because, of course, as we anticipated, our assumption has shifted from assuming a 2% Chapter 70 funding from this increase from the state. So he's going to walk us through what that means and how, at this point, I'm suggesting we close that additional gap. This conversation has happened with the three chairs, but we want to make sure the committee is kept up to date.
Rob? More.
Do you want mine? Here, I have extra.
Right down here.
Do you have enough?
Mm-hmm.
You have one for Zoe? Here, send that one down. I have my own.
Need more of that. Three more of these?
Oh, yeah, we don't have any.
I know.
This page 47R is revised as of 2-8 on the bottom of the next corner. The change, you can reinsert this into your budget books. The change on this page reflects the change in Chapter 7 assumptions. When we started building the budget, we assumed a 2% increase in Chapter 7. With the governor's budget coming out, the Chapter 7 increase is 0%. 0% over the final Chapter 70 allotment for FY 12. So you're going to look here and say, well, this level is funded, how come it's going up 48,000? Okay? So when we built our budget for FY 12, we built it with the amount that you see here, which is FY 11. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Mark. Then along comes June, and the state found they had extra money, and they made an extra allotment to municipalities, but also the regional school districts. And so there was an increase in Chapter 70 for us of $48,000. We'd already voted the budget, we had a budget, so rather than reopening the budget and increasing the budget or doing whatever, they just took it as extra income. Okay. So two things happened. One, that extra income goes into E&D, we'll get that in a minute. Mm-hmm. We can use that for next year. And two, when they say level funded, they're doing level funded from the final Chapter 70 number of FY 12. So effectively for us, it's an increase of 40,000. Okay, so with that, we still had a cut of 133,000. And the question then becomes, well, how do you fund that? And the superintendent looked at it, and the options are, well, you can fund it from some other source, or you can do cuts in that amount, 133,000, or some combination thereof. Didn't want to do cuts, mm-hmm. So we look at all the funding sources. Funding sources you can play with are assessments of other towns.
Not an option.
And so the other option was looking at using more E&D, which is what this presents, and you'll see in this version that the E&D budget support is now $233,000 instead of the $500,000 you saw in the original version of this budget. Okay? Any questions so far?
Yes. Rob, maybe for the new members and for the public, could you explain what E&D is?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Access and deficiency in a regional school district is similar to free cash in a town. And what it is, I don't know how it got E&D as a moniker, but it's really the cash in the general fund that is not earmarked for some other purpose. So other purposes would be things like encumbered expenses for the previous year, obligations for the next year, and what we have earmarked for use in the following year. So if you look at here, we would be using, in this case, $600,000 for E&D for budget support and $280,000 for an emergency fund. So those have earmarked things in the general fund aren't available for other purposes, which is how it means about unreserved funds available for other purposes. How they got from that to E&D, I don't know. But that's what E&D is. Historically, in our region, the regional agreement called for a maximum of 3.5% of the following year's budget could be carried forward as E&D. And once you go over that limit, 3.5%, Any additional funds are to be used to reduce member towns' assessments the following year. Now, the rest of the state has a cap of 5%. Actually, when the state certifies E&D every year, that's what they certify it against. So a number of towns have received certifications where you say, yeah, you're not close to the limit. And I'd look at it and say, well, we're pretty close to the limit. Harlan, it's different than everybody else's limit. So three years ago, the regional district voted to increase the E&D cap for our district to 5% to be on par with all the other districts in the state. So that's the brief history of E&D, what it is and how it works.
And also the regional school district is a separate entity, so that's why it has an E&D, whereas the elementary school is part of the town, so it's really the town's reserves that is the reserves for the elementary schools and everything else in the town.
That's a good point to know. The regional district legally is somewhat like a town. They're both governmental entities, distinct, separate entities.
So, could I would like to just jump in a little bit too. So, you know, the conversation we've had to have is, do we at this point make additional cuts when we have added what we believe to be essential to support our priorities, our budget priorities? At this point, my recommendation in speaking with the budget subcommittee was I would like to ask that we apply that additional E&D this year. We can look at in just a minute is the history of school choice usage, what we've used in school choice versus what we've used in E&D. And as I explained, and Rob explained at the four-town meeting, we have applied less school choice over the past most recent years. We used to apply much more because we had more choice coming in. Next year, we anticipate going back up to the prior or close to the prior limit of what we were bringing in for choice funds, which is around $700,000. So we saw a dip in the use of choice and an increase in E&D. So we are anticipating that swinging back next year. Again, when Rob will walk us through, one of the questions is how much E&D to use and how much do you anticipate replenishing at the end of a school year so that you keep it in a healthy place and not deplete. And you'll see the history of how Rob has worked very hard to make sure that we were being fiscally responsible to build up an E&D to a place that was solid because it affects your bond rating and other issues. So this is taking a little bit of a dip back. But also the plan of replenishing this at the end of this school year and ideally next year. So what you won't see tonight is any additional cuts coming in front of you. You'll see the same papers with adds and cuts. Nothing has shifted in that document from our last meeting.
Okay, so on the colorful page, you see the history of E&D. It's the same as what you have in your book, updated to reflect using $633,000 for the next year's budget support rather than the $500,000. And I've opened it up a little bit at the top. And before I go into next year, the following year, just I want to review what's happened in the past. So in the previous years, the lines that are green and below are years that have been certified by the state as, yes, that is what our E&D is. And you can see that what the percentage calculation is the amount at the end of fiscal 10, say, is what percentage of the total budget for FY11, including the operating budget and the capital budget. So combining those two, what percentage of that is this E&D certified? So you can see that going back to 2002, we had a pretty low reserve at 1%. And by 2006, we were up to 3.4. And at that point, we were living under a 3.5 cap. Okay? Mm-hmm. As we lifted the cap, we can
raising EMD as we could to get it up to a healthier level for bitter times such as these. What I've done in this version is shown what I expect to happen to EMD overall. So if during FY12, at the end of FY12, we're able to return $350,000 of unexpended funds from this year's budget to EMD, that will raise it. And then if we apply $633,000 for next year's budget, we reduce it. And so we're looking at potentially an EMD of 3.85% for FY12, the end of FY12, rather than 4.4%. Now, why the 350? Just want to remind you where that comes from. Number 300 of that is from unexpended out-of-district places for special education that are identified this year as you don't need it, and we cut it for next year's budget, and we have that conversation. And then 50,000 is other sort of things. Mm-hmm. So we usually have some vehicles back to EMD. Why? Because while we try to budget right on target, things happen during the year. And one thing we cannot do is spend more than we have in the budget. And so, since it's virtually impossible to come in at exactly zero, given the margin of safety, we'll invariably have a little bit left over, the little cushion that goes back into EMD. So that's the history and the projection for EMD. If you look forward to FY14, if at the end of FY13 we have 50,000 going back in and use 300,000, we'd have 633 down to 300,000 in EMD. That's still going to deplete EMD a bit, down to 2.96, but hopefully that will bias this transition period, this bridge period, for choice to come in online. So let's look at the choice piece. And so the second section is our history of choice.
Yeah. Sorry, can I just understand this, EMD? Mm-hmm. Because, so when I think of EMD, I sort of think of a fund balance. Mm-hmm. But it's sounding to me like what you're saying, if we look at that END number at as of 6/30/2011, the $1.4 million,
yep.
that has already, what's already been taken out of that $1.4 million is what we budgeted for END in FY12, which is
$830,000. It was $450,000.
Plus the 280 for contingency.
The 280 for contingency technically goes in the end of the year, it goes back out of the end of the year, because it's a fixed reserve for the thinkable. So it really doesn't affect you either way. It's a constant placeholder. Okay, so on June 30th, it goes in the EMD, and July 1st comes back out as part of this budget.
Okay, but on June 30th, the EMD for budget support comes out. The EMD for budget support for the next year comes out on June 30th as opposed to July 1.
Well, the EMD for budget support is spent along the way.
Right, but I'm trying to understand why in the END, your estimate of END at 6/30/2012, mm-hmm. you're subtracting out what we're potentially putting in the FY13 budget.
Right, but that's just the END for budget support line.
Right.
You don't see the 280 going back and forth.
Right, I am, that's what I'm talking about, the budget support. So at 6/30/2011, we took out the EMD for budget support for FY12. We took it out on 6/30. We don't take it, we actually take it out of that balance on 6/30.
The 6/30 doesn't come out at 6/30/11. It comes out of the EMD at 6/30/12.
Right. So, okay, I'm sorry, though. That's why I'm really confused by why you're subtracting out this $633,000 before you come up to your estimate of the balance at 6/30/2012, because the 633 is an FY13 number.
Yes, that's right. So, okay, so we're now in FY12, and by the time we get to the end of FY12, what the E&D balance at the end of last year was, will have been increased by the 350, but you also have reserved $633,000 in E&D for the fiscal 13 budget. So if we count E&D at the end of the FY12 year.
Even though, so that certified E&D balance isn't really a fund balance then, because you're subtracting
right.
out your next year's budget amount.
Yeah, this is E&D is just the unencumbered, unreserved part of the fund balance.
Okay.
The rest of the fund balance is things that are encumbered for prior expenses or reserved for budget support for the next year or that sort of thing. And we will be meeting in the next week or two to look at the audited financials for FY11, mm-hmm. and we're going to go through all this piece by piece as to what's in the fund balance and where you need to consider that.
The one thing I'd like to, before we go into choice, the one thing, too, I want to let the committee know that I've committed to with Rob, that as we're looking toward the end of the year, obviously we're being very fiscally responsible with spending, clearly. However, my commitment will be over the next few years to be committed to putting additional funds, whatever is there at the end of the year, back into E&D to keep that fund replenished. So the $50,000, you know, projected for to be entering back into E&D at the end of FY13 is conservative. And, you know, I would hope that number would increase. But again, you know, there's no guarantee. But that is the commitment that I've made to be very conscious of putting funds back in, because knowing that we are taking a bit of a dip and we want to make sure that we're replenishing mm-hmm. for the future.
On to the choice piece?
Mm-hmm. Please.
Okay. So the second section shows you the history of our choice revenue and expenditures from that revolving fund. So what is choice? So we have some choice, some slots available for kids who are choice into our district for their education in middle school and high school. And anybody can apply for slots that we have open.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is that the sending district, wherever they come from, Gulf Town or Happy, you know, wherever, ends up reimbursing us for $5,000 per student to here for a full year. So we look at students as FTEs. If they're here for a full year, it's one FTE, you get $5,000. If you're here for half the year, the half FTE, you get $2,000. Plus, if they have special ed needs, those costs to provide special ed services are fully reimbursed by the sending district as well. So it's two streams. And put those together, that brings revenue into our district. And we put it into a revolving fund. And then through a revolving fund, we use some of those funds to support the following year budget. So what you'll see here is, for instance, in FY10, we brought in $436,000 in revenue, and we spent $650,000 in that fund to support the budget. So the fund balance went down to $213,000, but we ended the year with $500,000 in that fund. Skipping ahead, for FY12, we're projecting to bring in $487,000 based on the enrollments we had as of December, and we have budgeted to use $300,000 from that fund for this year's budget. So we should end this year with a balance of $470,000. Now we're opening additional slots next year, and we are projecting bringing in up to $717,000. But you'll see that we're spending $470,000. Which is how much we had left at the end of this year. If that was the fund balance, we're going to take that and plunk it down to support next year's budget. Next year, we bring in 717. We end the year with a fund balance of 717. And lo and behold, in FY14, we plan on plunking down to full 717 for budget support. Okay? So as Maria alluded to earlier, you go back to FY05, we were drawing down $900,000 from that fund until more tourist kids come in. Mm-hmm. Now we've dipped down, and now we're coming back up. And for our new members, I would point out that the reason we do it this way is because we want to have the money in the fund before we spend it the following year. Because this is, after all, choice. Okay? So we think the choice kids are coming. We don't know until they actually walk in the door. Mm-hmm. They could make a different choice over the summer, right? So to be cautious, we just roll it that way. Oh, it's 1 year. Okay, so putting those two pieces together, if you look at the bottom section, FY12, mm-hmm. we're using $300,000 from choice and $450,000 from E&D for total budget support from the two sources together of mm-hmm. $750,000. And in the materials we just looked at, we're now projecting using the $470,000 from choice, as we have, and now $633,000 from E&D for $1.1 million of budget support for FY13 from these two sources. And then you can see what Maria was talking about earlier, mm-hmm. in FY14, it switches. Mm-hmm. Choice goes up to $717,000, E&D goes down to $300,000. It's about the same level of budget support from two sources, mm-hmm. but the amount from each has switched. Now we're not trading E&D as fast anymore. And after that, you can look to replenishing the and getting stable again.
Yep. That was very helpful for me anyway, for the community to see it run through.
So it does dip us down a bit, but it gets us through this period, and we'll see how it will play out.
And if we could say to the committee, too, that especially for the new members, we've, you know, my statements to the four towns, and it's a similar statement that I'm making to Amherst around the Amherst budget. We really need a year of stability to do some of our internal work to make sure that we are putting in place interventions. We're looking at aligning our curriculum, focusing on differentiation, looking at the use of time and such in our schools, so that we need a year to be able to see what the budget picture looks like in the future. So for right now, that's the goal, is to have a level of stability without significant cuts. So this is where this gap being filled with E&D allows us to have that for a year.
Any questions?
Yep. I have a request. I don't know if it's appropriate to ask for that.
Okay.
The chair of Leverett and myself would like to request that there be a review of the enrollment figures for the four towns. Mm-hmm. In our opinion, the 3% seems to be a tad high mm-hmm. of an increase.
So how is the five-year-old average?
Right. Okay. If you could take another look at that and get back to us before the 28th, that would be appreciated. Thank you.
Great. Debbie.
Not a question, but a comment. So in looking back over the years, at least the past 4 or 5 years, it seems to me that we're pretty conservative about budgeting, about our expenditure budgets. And in fact, since 2008, rather than using E&D, we've actually been adding to E&D each year since then. And, you know, that's not a bad thing. I think it's good to be conservative in our mm-hmm. expenditure budgets. But I guess for me, it's one of the reasons I'm not as concerned about this for this mm-hmm. year, using this amount, because I do think we're conservative. I suspect we will not use that much of E&D, but it will help us to continue maintaining healthy programs mm-hmm. for this year. Now, obviously, if at the end of the year it turns out for some bizarre reason Rob wasn't ultra conservative this mm-hmm. year, and you know, we will have to reevaluate, but right. but I think that at least looking at the recent past, that's seemed to be the case.
In full disclosure, I'll accept conservative, but not ultra-conservative. Because while we have been conservative, and that's a prudent way of approaching it, we've also been very lucky. And we've been lucky with a couple breaks along the way, including paid jobs dropping on us, which was a nice piece of money for a couple of years that really isn't part of our ongoing regular mix. It just fell on us, and we took it and worked with it. And the other piece that we've been talking about recently is we've really been able to bring special ed services in-house, and I've been able to, like, pare down the last few years how much we have to spend out of district. So, you know, that's like a one-time shift, and hopefully it stays there, it doesn't go back up the other way. But that's not really conservative budgeting. That's part luck, part good clinical management. So there's those factors as well. I can't possibly take credit for it. Hopefully, in this case, I think.
Okay, if nothing else, we're moving on to four towns meeting discussion.
Thank you, Rob.
I saw.
So, would you like me to start?
Sure.
So, the four towns meeting is Saturday from 8:30 to 10:30. Rob will and will be putting together packets of this updated information for the four towns to review and you know, be kept up to date with our current situation. And, you know, it would be helpful to hear from the committee if there are other things such as enrollments that would be helpful for people to have for your committee's consideration for Saturday. We also really, I think it's just it's a time to check in to see how people are, you know, looking at budget needs, because we recognize that this is a challenge for some of our communities more than others to reach this level of support for our schools. So I think for me it would be very helpful if there are points that you'd like us to consider and address on Saturday, would be helpful to hear, or if there's anything that you know that you'd like to, that your communities have asked to share in advance. And then I don't know if there are other points that the committee themselves wanted to address on this topic. No. Anything else, Kip? Okay. Also, I also wanted to mention just kind of an update for those who were at the last four town meeting. One of the conversations we had, which was raised from Leverett, was to look at some of the unfunded mandates for the schools and the implication of having the state not fully fund aspects of our school requirements. So we did have that follow-up conversation where Kip Fonch and Farshid Hajir and Peter DiRico came and met with our staff, and we started to compile what these unfunded mandates are, and to consider, you know, the possibility of looking at ways to either take some action to consider if there's a way to reduce some of the, maybe increase the revenue for some of these factors that affect our schools. So we are pulling this information together that we will be sharing, and as we get closer to if we're going to take any action at the state level to bring up these topics, we'll bring them to the committee. But we just wanted to let you know that we have taken that step to start exploring. And Rob, can I also say another budget update? Did we just get notification that for this year there's a the state is reimbursing for McKinney-Vento transportation? Can you tell me what that is, because I knew there was one other piece.
I didn't bring that with me, but
I'm sorry.
Some other districts, I've been applying unfunded mandates too, imagine. And one of the ones that pops up in our conversation, is the requirement to transport McKinney-Vento students. So that is students who are homeless or displaced, and are living and have had to move to a different community, but really should continue their schooling where they've been, right? Mm-hmm. And so there's a provision in the law that the two residence areas, two towns, whatever it is, share the cost of transporting kids to their home school, if you will, even though they don't live in that town anymore. So there's a cost of all the transport, so that's called McKinney-Vento transportation cost. So some of these little towns, went to Attorney General's office?
I think it, I can't, was it the auditor, state
auditor? Auditor's office, yes. And said, you know, look, we're incurring these large expenses. These towns are incurring over $40,000, $300,000. It's an unfunded mandate. Either you all need to help us pay for this or we shouldn't have to do it. And the state auditor found in their favor and is sending a piece of action to the Department of Education and to the legislature. The calculation that the auditor did was that the total amount was $11 million?
Yeah, I think that's what it was.
About $11 million statewide in funded costs incurred by school districts. And they've done a little calculation as to how much would come to each district. And in, I don't know how they get these numbers, but I think it would be that Amherst would receive something like $5,000 and the region would get $10,000. Which would help.
Right.
But I really don't know how they got those numbers, so I couldn't bank it just yet, even if it had gotten funding. But right now it's just a proposal from the auditor of the state saying that this should be funded. So stay tuned, we'll see what happens.
Well, do we have a line item in our budget where we know what our actual cost is for that item?
Yes.
Do you know generally?
I don't know exactly. I can look it up, though.
Okay. You don't have to look it right now.
Okay, but I can, yeah, thanks.
Is it in transportation?
I think it's on
a separate paragraph.
There is, and it talks about the current, and it, I think there's a graph also of the number of students we're currently serving. Yeah. Thank you, Rob, because I knew I wasn't getting that correct.
Rob? So I just, I'm actually taking it back to lunch. I just want to see if I kind of get the take-home message here correct, and I'm worried I didn't. So is it that, so the vision of how we're seeing the funding happening in the future is that we're drawing down E&D and we're relying more heavily on school choice funds over time. Is that?
Well, we're going to draw down E&D for a year or two.
And then bring it back up?
Until we get the revenue coming in from choice, and then choice revenue will go up, and I think E&D will go down. So
the choice money is going to end up supporting and supporting the E&D fund, not necessarily the operating budget.
Well, it's the same thing, because this is how we draw E&D to support the operating budget. Draw from the choice revenue to support the operating budget. So if you look, so if you look at the bottom, so the total budget support on the right, where by 12,772,000 to FY13, $1.1 million, but it's only 470 choice and 633 DMD. The next year, still about the same total budget support of $1 million, but now choice revenue is 717, E&D is only 300. So it goes back to drawing it down at a much lower rate, similar to what we did in FY10 and FY11. So we're just drawing more heavily for a couple of years to get us to the place where that choice revenue increases again.
And the assumption is that the choice revenue will stay solid. Mm-hmm. Right? Is there any concern about that, I guess?
Well, since it's choice, you always have to wonder. On the other hand, we've never had unfilled choice slots. Mm-hmm. Just want to come here.
In our history.
Historically, maybe that's happened at those levels.
Yes. I'm feeling fairly confident that we'll see, absolutely.
Okay. Thanks.
Rob, one question, too. Sure. Are there any rules about what your revolving fund for choice has to stay at, like based on number of students, or is it our rules or your state?
Choice, we have latitude.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask one more budget piece before we move on? Kip, did you, I'm remembering from our meeting the other day, did you want to talk about letter writing to the state around increasing Chapter 70? Did we talk about that? And am I...
Yeah, we talked about writing letters to Kulik, Rosenberg, regarding reexamining the legislature's, or the, excuse me, the governor's decision to allocate money for those schools which appear to be increasing enrollment, moving them to the foundation amount as opposed to places like the region that are having declining enrollment. I personally wrote a letter to Kulik, and his response was that he understands the inequity of it, but he doesn't understand the rationale behind it, and that there are also other legislators from those towns that are similar to ours that did not get any money at all that are very upset about this. So I don't think we've heard the last word about it, but it would help if there could be some letters written to, to the various legislators in regards to taking another look at that decision.
And do you think that's more powerful coming from the committee as a whole or individuals? Or
I leave it open to the committee to decide that.
I'd personally be very much in favor of that. But
maybe sending it as different committees.
If we do it, I would suggest that we write it local representatives, but also to the Senate and House leaders as well, and maybe even the education committees of both the houses.
Would you be willing to draft that, or we could look at it next meeting? Maybe?
Why are you saying that with a smirk on
your face? Because you kind of did already, right?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
That would be wonderful.
Yeah.
We also want to hit the House Ways and Means Committee, the folks in their budget decisions.
Thank you. Thank you, Kip.
Yeah, thank you.
So can I just to come here first,
ask another question back to this budget. So, things are still really changing on the revenue side.
Right.
So, I guess my question is, what happens if Chapter 70 doesn't even, what if there's a cut to Chapter 70? I mean, are we thinking this is sort of the maximum drawdown, in which case if that comes, that occurs, we're going to have to look elsewhere? Or I'm just curious what you're thinking about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that when we looked at the the information that we have at this time, we're feeling fairly as confident as we can be that this is a reasonable projection with, zero but no further cut. However, if we have an additional decrease in funding, we're going to have to come back to the table. And I'm not sure at that point I would ask us to go any deeper into E&D. So then it's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, one other thing, I'm sure it's affected some of the other towns as well, is that we didn't get any increase in levy. So one of the reasons why we feel so much pressure at the 71,000 increase, which is still looking kind of difficult, that sort of complicated the position.
Right.
Because we were counting on that as well for the elementary.
Yep.
And so this is, because we didn't get that, this becomes an even more onerous hit, not on the region, but on the elementary level. So it's still...
Absolutely.
Issue for us.
Yes, it is. And it's a hard balance to have to look at both.
Very hard.
I'm sorry. Do you want me to do that?
Okay, so that's it. See most of you at the four towns meetings. So school calendar for 12-13.
Okay. So Debbie's actually going to talk to us a little bit about the process of looking at the school calendar and what you have in front of you and make note. This is our first. It's a very much a draft. Our process typically, we'll bring this in front of the committee. We have two options. We then go to the APEA and ask for their feedback as well. Before we come back with a final recommendation for the committee. But I'd love to have Debbie just kind of walk you through what you're seeing in front of you.
You get to talk into this?
Oh, no. basically, what you have in front of you is a pre-Labor Day calendar draft and a post-Labor Day calendar draft, which is what we always typically present to APEA for their consideration. So far, the only folks who have really vetted this. The principals had a look at it today. The district directors have had a look at it. We don't know yet, you know, which one APA may prefer, but this will be going out to them within the next, probably, I would think, the next couple of days.
Exactly.
But what we have done, we have to schedule 180 days with students and 184 days for teachers. And as you probably recall, during this current year, for the first time, the decision was made to have two of the curriculum days up front, which resulted in a staggered ending of this school year, with the elementary schools ending a day earlier than the regional schools. The principals and directors agreed today that we will have just one of the curriculum days up front for FY13, which means we'll have the same end date for the school year. But basically what you're looking at, if one of these was approved as written, if we approved the pre-Labor Day start, students would be back to school on August 30th. That would be for all students other than kindergarten. Kindergarten students would start two school days later, which would be September 4th, the day after Labor Day. If we approve a post-Labor Day start, students would begin on September 4th, the day after Labor Day, and kindergarten students would start 2 days later on the 6th. One of the drawbacks to the post-Labor Day start is it would put us fairly late into June. If we didn't use any of our snow days, the earliest day we would get out would be June 18th. Potentially, if we used all five, we would be at June 25th, which is sort of the situation we're in this year. The ending dates look much better on the pre-Labor Day start. June 14th, the earliest possible last day of school. June 21st, if we use our five snow days. One of the issues that will be discussed about the pre-Labor Day start is the way it makes the first trimester end for students. It would be ending right before the Thanksgiving holiday. Which would be great for students, but it's a little difficult for teachers because they would come back to school and immediately be getting grades out and starting the new trimester. And I think the only other thing to draw your attention to in the draft, because we have, I believe it's two of the elementary schools, not all three, that are polling sites, because this is a presidential election year, there's always concerns with elections about people coming into the building, having access to the building, who are not quarried. So the principals have recommended that the elementary teachers' work day be scheduled on election day. That way, students aren't in the building, they can be used for polling, teachers can still be in there working. It's just different from what families are used to, because traditionally our work days are on either Monday or Friday, so that students have a long weekend. It would be on a Tuesday this time.
Okay. I was wondering if you could just clarify, Maria. There are three titles for some of these days. Mm-hmm. There's curriculum, there's professional development, and there's work day.
That's just my error when I was sitting this together, because
it's all the same.
We sort of use them interchangeably, professional day and curriculum day.
However, work day is teacher work time to transition from trimester or half years, you know, for elementary students.
And well, and in terms of your goals, which, if any, of those days will be devoted to teachers working in teams or what have you to towards those goals?
The two curriculum days, or PD days, depending on how they are,
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
In addition to other times that have been scheduled within our work day. Again, that's a priority to make that time for teachers for their own development.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Debbie, then Rob.
So first, just a comment and then a question. I think starting 2 days before Labor Day, I've never felt that to be a good idea, to have a couple days of school and then break for Labor Day. it seems to me that those 2 days aren't as effective as they could be if we started the day after Labor Day, and that's just my personal opinion about it. I don't think those 2 days, those extra 2 days at the end of June, it's still the end of June, you know, the 21st to the 25th, I don't see that that makes that much of a difference. My question is about Good Friday, and probably I've seen this before, but I never really registered that there's no school due to budgetary constraints.
We have so many staff who take that as a holiday, that getting enough subs for to fill the buildings is an issue. And we made this decision, I want to say 3 years ago, 2 years ago, Mark is saying two. Was it peace or is it three? So it was 3 years ago. He's telling me peace. Yes, it's three. All right. A few years ago, we made this decision because it was so challenging. It was such a lost day, and it was the cost was exorbitant, and we just couldn't get enough subs.
So, I'm sorry, Rick. Can I just respond? So. It's a little bit misleading to say due to budgetary constraints, because it makes it sound like if we just threw money at the problem, it wouldn't be a problem. But it sounds like it's a bigger problem than the cost of the substitutes. It's not being able to find substitutes. It's the students' absences.
There was a deliberate thought around this at the time.
I can tell you the history. And to be honest, what happens, I pull up my draft from previous years, and I use that and plug things in. The first year we did this, it was truly a budgetary constraint. It was when we were making massive, massive cuts. And because of the number of subs you have to bring in, that was in addition to not being able to find enough subs, you have to bring in so many that it is rather costly. So it really was budgetary. But that should actually probably come out of this.
And I also think it was important to say that we're not choosing a religious holiday because the fact that there's another factor that's requiring us to have the day off.
Yeah. One question. So on this proposed calendar, the elementary teacher's work day in November, was that the one that was typically in January? There has been recently, the last couple years, a teacher work day in January.
The teacher work day, I think, is February now. Isn't that the one that would be the typical?
Oh, February 1st.
Yeah, the one in November is the election day.
And then my other question, Debbie, is I'm missing a day when I compare last year to this year. So last year we started on the 6th of September. It's a leap year, so that gives you one extra day. Mm-hmm. But then the high school students ended earliest possible on the 18th, which is the same as the proposed calendar. We're starting on the 4th in this proposed calendar. Earliest is the 18th. Where am I missing a day? The post-Labor Day, which... Mm-hmm. So where am I missing a day in there?
Yes, we had an extra day in December vacation this year because New Year's Day fell on the weekend.
Oh, that's right.
And so we had to come back on the 3rd instead of the 2nd.
Right, because Monday was a bad day.
Mm-hmm. And this, for some reason, the December holidays just fall beautifully this year, 24th through the 28th in 1 week. But just for full disclosure, because this is still a draft, I'll have probably 20 other people count and recount to make sure I've got the right number of days, because after counting it several times, it starts.
Yeah. No, my question wasn't really that you missed a day. I was wondering if it had to do with changing the work days. But the elementary students are the ones who changed the work day, not the region, correct?
Mm-hmm. Right. And this year, the elementary teachers did have two of their work days, or professional development days, up front before school started, and they are moving one back into the school year. So that's another factor.
I was just going to respond to the idea of that starting on Thursday before Labor Day. That's how we've always done it until this year, I feel like, it's sometimes been right before Labor Day and sometimes not. But starting on a Thursday, I think, I don't know if this is necessarily representative of most students, but I feel like it might be a good idea because we're coming from summer and then you go back to school for just 2 days, ease into it, and then have a long weekend again.
It's like a transition period, because you don't want to go to school like the first day and have lots of homework and like lots of work, and you're kind of like, oh my gosh, yesterday was summer. So it's kind of a nice, easy
transition.
Yeah.
I've heard the same from people
so
as well.
So I'd say that might actually be positive. And as to the exams being right before Thanksgiving, how were they this year?
They were the week after Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm. So that's how it would be if we started after Labor Day.
Mm-hmm.
That might be something to see if we can ask high school students their preference.
I mean, I know I'm personally kind of like having exams before, because it's like you review a lot in class before, and I feel like having the long weekend kind of, you get even more stressed out about it.
Right.
At least I know I did this year.
Yeah.
So I think it kind of helps to like get it all done the week before and then not have to worry about it over the break. Because people go away also, and then it's hard to come back and have exams.
I could see that being a problem if then teachers had to grade exams over Thanksgiving
break, though.
No. So that'd be something to ask the teachers about, too.
Thank you. And we're going to have to look at all of that. And I know it'll go back to the high school now. So Mr. Jackson will be taking a look at that with his team. Also, I just wanted to mention, for Leverett and Shutesbury, you know, Pelham's on our same schedule, mm-hmm. but for Leverett and Shutesbury, we did reach out just to say, just try to see mm-hmm. when curriculum mm-hmm. days were happening, and is there any way to coordinate so that mm-hmm. we can do some collaborative work? Right. So we're, you know, trying to open the door there as mm-hmm. well. So this will be back in front of you again.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, policy subcommittee update.
Let me do the update, obviously, first and give you a sense of where we're heading and what we might be able to bring to you in the next month or two. I'm hopeful that we will have a buses idling policy, if that's the right grammatical way to say it. For you, maybe not in February, but certainly by March, I think we will have that.
Mm-hmm.
We're also looking at class size guidelines, and perhaps most significantly and most bearing on recent discussions, we have invited the athletic director, Mr. Farrow, to join us on Monday, which is our next policy subcommittee meeting, to have a conversation with us about his views on advertising and sponsorship.
Right.
So I don't think we'll have a proposal for you for a while yet, but we are starting to look at that.
Okay.
Yes.
I also wanted to mention that I met with some parents today regarding class size and gave some input into some language change. You know, what would be considered, what is a target versus, you know, what is the cap.
Mm-hmm.
So I would love to come and be able to share that mm-hmm. information with the subcommittee when you're talking about.
When we've had guests before,
mm-hmm.
the guests have taken up our entire meeting. So
I will be very quick.
Well, no.
Or I can email.
Why don't you wait until we come to get you?
Please, please do. Oh, that's great. So come let me know when you want me to be there, because I'd love to share that.
I'm not sure we will make it on Monday, but. That's on the agenda.
Catherine?
Yeah, I was at this meeting as well, and I think the three terms were target, cap, and maximum.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of outside maximum.
And defining what we mean by that. Yeah. And
yeah. If you have anything along the email it to me, and I'll be at the meeting, okay?
All right, thanks.
I'm sorry,
Rob. Well, I guess I was just going to say, I think it's great, and I love a lot of things for the subcommittee structure, for particularly these two issues, the mm-hmm. class size guidelines and the sponsorship of schools. I'm hoping that we can have kind of a full committee discussion on this before a policy
Absolutely.
Comes to us for like a first reading or anything like that. I kind of think these are one mm-hmm. some of the ones that should be discussed in committee first, then go to policy for like writing and tweaking, then come back as a reading. So
okay.
I think the subcommittee would actually prefer to work on it a little bit because we're a smaller group.
Mm-hmm.
Bring something to you, not for a first reading,
Great.
But just to respond to and have it evolve kind of organically, if you will. But I don't think our intention would be to bring something with you immediately for a first reading. That, for something that potentially controversial, that wouldn't be appropriate.
Right. But then I guess, just in response, what I'm looking forward to is a full committee discussion where the superintendent presents some
mm-hmm.
data and information
yep.
about class size guidelines, and we have a discussion about that
mm-hmm.
long before we get a policy written or changed.
Okay. Amherst, we have placed it on the agenda for our next Amherst meeting for that level, because we are going to, I'll bring information and we can start to weigh in, and I can share that information. I don't remember when your next meeting is, but we can do that. I also have another, just an update on one consideration for some revisions.
I
understand the preference of wanting to do it in a smaller group and bring something with some structure around it. Well, part of, but then I also agree that this is a full committee discussion, or I'd like it to be. But will you bring some research or some of the research you've done around it at that time?
Well, as I was going to note, our researcher usually handles those responsibilities, and she's not here this evening, but since we're live, I was going to give her a heads up and lots of loving over this videotape, but I'm sure Elaine would be able to do that
for us.
That'd
be great. Thanks.
We're also, after we finish, well, not finish, but after we look at that, our next items are Section A and Section C, so that should keep us busy for a while. What you have in front of you, I mentioned Elaine. She was kind enough and on top of things enough so that she's able to provide you with a synopsis, if you will, a brief commentary on each of the policies that you have before you. You notice most of these are changes relative to laws. The other thing I would bring to your attention, and what we're basically concentrating on, are those policies that the last time they were looked at was perhaps before some of you were born. That's sort of what we're looking at in terms of Sections A and C. Quite a few of these in the early, mid-80s. I wish I could add more to comments that Elaine has provided with you, but I think she's done a really excellent job of covering all the points, so but I'll be happy to answer any questions you have.
So policy AC is first, and this is a first reading on this one, right?
Yes, on all of them.
On all of them, okay. Any questions on policy AC? Yes, on
detailed points?
Sure, yeah.
There's a period after the first few words that should be a comma.
Yep.
Thank you for pointing that out, Sam.
You're welcome. That's it.
Any other comments on policy AC? Policy AC is commitment to non-discrimination and educational equity. Okay, if no questions on that, we'll move on to the next one, which is policy ACB, Affirmative Action on Cultural Diversity. Any comments, Yasong?
In point two, and a staff which includes individuals from historically marginalized groups, I wondered about saying something about currently marginalized groups or kind of including, I don't know, not just focusing on history, but what is actually the situation now in some form.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments on ACB?
I'm just sort of struck by how long it's been since this has been updated. That's a long time.
I know, and they're plugging through these.
One point about that, if I may.
Please.
And I did point out that in the past, if they've been looked at and there weren't changes, they didn't change the date at the bottom because there was no vote on them. So some of them have been looked at, just not changed.
Thank you. So, to follow up on that, what we're planning on doing is, if we don't make any changes, to add that the policy was reviewed in 2012.
Okay, so if nothing else on ACB, moving on to BDFA, school councils. Any questions on this? Yes,
Point A, the council should include, et cetera, and for the high school, at least one student representative. Could we state clearly that it's a possibility, if it is meant to be a possibility, to have a student representative on any of the other councils? Is that meant to be a possibility?
When you talk, you're talking about councils from, this policy covers the region, Amherst, and Pelham. Is that what you're referring to?
It's one council, which is a specific council. It's the school council that works with the, provides an advisory to the principal. Is that what you're asking, Solomon?
It's one council per school, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yes.
Yeah, so for the high school, it says it should have at least one student
okay.
representative.
I'm
saying for the
saying
middle
now.
School, for the elementary schools, each of the schools, is that
oh.
is it possible to have a
oh,
student
I see.
Representative on those? And I wouldn't suggest mandating that, but just
as
clarify the wording so that
I mean, as
I'll certainly add to our discussion. Okay.
That would also change the wording at the second to last paragraph on the first page there. There's only one page. No, there are two pages.
Right. I'm just going to comment on that. I mean, I think you could have a discussion about it for the middle school. I would not vote for it for the elementary schools. So I just wouldn't be in favor of a student representative on the school council of the elementary schools. So.
Yeah. Kristen?
I think it's certainly permissible, allowable. The way the law is written, it, there has to be a student in the, at the high school level, is my understanding from Lane, but not that it's not mandating in other spaces, but it absolutely could happen. So
I had a question on this. Unless I missed it, it doesn't say how the members are elected. Was there any discussion about
that? I think we were leaving it up to individual schools. Otherwise, it's going to get pretty...
Yeah.
You take away some autonomy from the
school. It says like teacher and student members are elected by their peers.
It's elected.
It does speak to...
It does. Okay, maybe I missed it.
Point A.
Okay.
The
exact method and what that means is
yeah.
up to each school.
Yeah.
Okay. Solomon?
One other bit of punctuation in the very last paragraph. Superintendent for approval. It's missing the period.
Last paragraph.
Line two, first sentence. That's no period.
See who's still in courses and doing this
definitely.
Work, which is good.
Yeah.
Right, you just need the period. There's the double space.
Anything else on BDFA? Okay, moving on to BDFB, School Improvement Plan.
The only thing that's different here is that we split what was the previous policy in two.
Yep.
Basically the difference.
Okay.
Any comments on BDFB? Okay, moving on to the next one, which is policy JH, students, absences, tardiness, and truancy.
May I?
Yeah.
There are, as you'll note, quite a few changes in this, probably more than in any other policy that we've brought forward. So I certainly would encourage you to look at these changes very, very carefully between now and the next time we look at it, because you may find something is either, you know, mistakenly stated or may say something you don't think the policy should say. There are just a lot of changes here,
okay.
So be careful with that.
Right.
So my question is on the language that adds the requirement for a healthcare provider's note after 3 days of being out with illness, and that appears to be new. I'm wondering where we got the 3 days, how we came up with that number.
That's historic, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't think it is new.
Oh, it's in bold.
Mm-hmm.
That made me assume it was new or changed.
Well, I think it's just part of a larger...
I can check for you, Rob, because I am not aware of that being new, but I could check and see where that came from. And get it back to
I just have medical questions about it,
yeah,
being a physician, because, so my kindergartner has been out for 2 days with fever these last 2 days. She's
right.
still got a fever. She's probably going to be out tomorrow. And I think as a parent and a physician, mm-hmm. I don't really feel she needs a trip to the doctor, and I feel like that could be kind of onerous in terms of money and time for certain. And I'm not opposed to the idea of a day limit, but I'm wondering how we came up with three, because I kind of feel that lots of viral illnesses can sometimes go 3 days. So that's just
doctor,
my question.
And it well, is it's true. Just, I know.
And I have people come to my emergency room saying, you know, I don't really need to be here, but I need a note to go back to school, or I need a note to go back to work. And I find that in that case, it's.
I think the latter is the origin or genesis of the 3 days. It's a very much an employer number. And it, that may be part of the reason
why it's
historically
here. Yeah, we do. It's in our contract language.
Like I said, I'm not opposed to a number, but I think four or five might make more sense to me than three, but that's just, I don't know. I'd like to, I don't have any hard data on that.
Yep.
I'd be curious to know if the members of, if members of the committee see a distinction that needs to be made between that number for elementary students and for secondary students. I don't know if that might be an issue of some sort. But there's just a lot to think about that and other things.
Catherine?
Yeah, and I also sort of wondered about the note from the physician versus a note from the parent. I mean, I'm thinking about, I have a lot of children, and on any number of occasions, my kids have been sick at home for 3 or 4 days with this or that, and I've spoken to the doctor on the phone, but I'm not necessarily taking them in, and I've always written a note myself. So, I mean, you know, it would be somewhat of a burden for parents to have to go down to the doctor's office to pick up the note, even if they didn't take their child in, whatever. So, maybe think about.
Absolutely.
Debbie, then Solomon.
So I agree that 3 days I think is onerous, and I think it in fact encourages parents to send their kids back to school when maybe they're not quite ready, so they don't, you know, when you know they're not sick enough to go to the doctor, but they're really not well enough to come back to school. And is there a difference between high school and elementary? In my experience, there is, but I don't know that it needs to be delineated in the policy. I'm not sure that's really necessary for the policy.
I think
the difference is in the secondary level, particularly the high school, it's three absences or more than that, and you lose credit, and it requires an appellate or appeal process.
That's
a huge difference in policy.
So that's
not so much policy, but an implementation of the policy.
But I think it's worth exploring the numbers of days and seeing how that fits with the secondary, you know, attendance process, but also just think about what's reasonable. What are other school districts doing for a number of days? I think it's
Solomon who's next.
I was going to respond to that.
When Kip said, the 3 days and lose credit, though, that's three unexcused absences, correct? Not three excused absences. You don't lose credit for 4 excused absences.
No.
It would only be excused at this point if you had a doctor's
right.
note.
Right, so that's where we have
someone
to.
Someone's gone for 7 days and the parent writes the note saying
he was sick.
On the last paragraph, on the first page, it says college visits, exchange trips, or school-sponsored field trips. And then later on it says that these won't count towards loss of credit, but they're not under any of these five exceptions at the beginning. Should we put an exception number 6, these three things, or is that some other category?
We'll certainly look at it. I think that's the kind of question that ultimately is answered by the committee as a whole, but we can certainly bring back if the committee wants us to come back with that revision, we certainly could do that, and then the committee as a whole would vote on it. We don't make those. We try not to make those decisions for the committee.
So two things I'm hearing you could use some feedback on. One is number of sick days. Do we have a sense of what? Well, Maria can talk to her staff about that and come back. But also, what do we think, Rob?
Well, just one suggestion might be to have something with a little bit more leeway for the administration. You could say something like, if a student is absent for, you could say 3 or more days or 4 or more days due to illness, the administration may request a note from the healthcare provider. And then you could set a harder limit and say, if a student is absent 5 or 6 days in a row for illness, a note will be required. That's just one possible. I don't know. It's just a suggestion. Like,
that's helpful. That's helpful
like
language.
Like a soft, like, we might request it from you, especially if a particular student has had problems.
Or if it's a pattern of absences.
Exactly.
But I think one of the reasons why we don't do that and have a policy is to remove arbitrariness.
Yeah, you're right.
I hear what you're saying, but...
Yeah. No, I agree with that, too. So I would say at least 4, but that's just me.
Yeah. No, that's helpful. And I will look into seeing what other districts do, and I'll talk with people who I know have spent a lot of time with these topics and see what their sense is, and I'll come back and can share that. Yeah, I could do that. Yeah, if Debbie reminds me, I can make sure I do that. No, it's not. I could have something by Monday. Sure, absolutely.
And then do we think we should add a number 6, like Solomon suggested, to cover that last paragraph?
What I would want to check, the only... I'm sorry, I'm jumping in.
Yeah, go ahead.
The thing I'd like to check is that some of this goes by law, the attendance piece, and there are very specific reasons that you're exempt in terms of what's considered truancy. And I'm not sure... So I would just want to check that. So I'm not opposed to, but I want to make sure it...
I think the difference here in the from the student's perspective is the mark of excused absence or unexcused absence, and that you'd like these things, college visits, exchanges, field trips, to be marked as excused, in which case I think they'd probably have to be one of these 5 things, but maybe not.
Okay. And certainly the practice at the high school, at least it was when I was there, was that any college trip or related kind of absence was almost pro forma excused.
Yeah.
I think it is.
Yeah, it is still.
I'm so sorry.
Go ahead, Debbie, then Kristen.
It does mention under high school absences, there's a line that says school-sponsored field trips, exchange programs, and a limited number of college visits per year will not count toward the absence limit for class credit. So I know that's not exactly what you were saying, but... it is addressed in some way.
My memory of our discussion was that that these 5 were related to the law.
The law.
Right. And we also recognize that that the field trips and things like that should be excused. And so underneath the absences, you see by law, only the superintendent or his or her designee may excuse necessary absences for other causes. That's another cause that we're just kind of saying you don't even have to ask about it.
Then I wouldn't recommend any change.
Thank you.
Oh, Rob.
I have another medical question. under urgent medical or dental treatment, I assume that's state mandated. But that defines urgent. So what do students do for medical appointments?
Like, I don't know how much they're excused at this moment if it's not considered an urgent medical appointment.
Just schedule them for after school?
Yes.
Okay, anything else?
That sounds like it's state mandated.
I don't know that it's state mandated. Okay. I'm not sure of that. I won't speak to that one. I can do the 5, but not.
I think the origins of what appears to be very, very strict rules about that has its origins in time and learning issues years ago, making sure that kids, students, are in school 180 days, 960, whatever. And so I think that's sort of the motivation behind that kind of limited wiggle.
There's also the process of appealing to the principal when you've exceeded days. So there is a process to go in and say, here's my reason why I needed to, and I want you to consider exempting me from that. So I think there's always that option, possibility.
So I only have one other question about this one, and it's the very last paragraph. If parents / guardians choose to remove a student from school for an extended time, they will be required to withdraw the student and will be required to submit a home education plan. But what if they're not educating the student at home? What if there are other arrangements? Or maybe this is just a technical legality that it's called that?
It's homeschool. So if you go on sabbatical and you take your child out for a month, for instance, instead of, like, arguing that that should be excused, you basically apply for homeschooling application, and you say, this is what's going to happen while they're gone, and this is how we're going to, you know, create the educational plan. And
But I guess my point is, what if you're not homeschooling them? What if you're withdrawing them and putting them in another educational institution where, you know...
If it's, say you're going to another country and you're taking them for a month and they're going somewhere, it's you can choose to disenroll and re-enroll, or you can say, I'm providing my child an experience by taking a couple courses here. That would be more of a homeschool plan. But it's trying to put some parameters around that students are required to go to school. So many, you know, they're supposed to. So it's just giving options to,
right.
Which has happened historically at times where people have withdrawn their children for a prolonged period of time, but have not provided any parameters around what the educational opportunities were for those kids during that period of time. Does that make any sense?
I'm just being nitpicky, but yep. It seems like you have two choices. You have to, you know, you're required to withdraw your student, and you can either put them in another school or
right.
You can homeschool them. But you don't have to submit a home education plan if you're not homeschooling them. That's, I guess, my only point.
However, some people, when they homeschool, if, say, you're going on a trip and you're homeschooling, or even here homeschooling, you may have your child enrolled in a course, but it does not constitute a full school day, and you still submit a homeschool plan. So kids who may go and take a course at something at North Star or something else, that still constitutes a plan of how you're going to provide access to your child for an educational experience. Unless it's a school where they're enrolling, you have to create that unique plan, whether it's home or abroad or wherever you may be. Is that
right?
Yeah.
So I guess
yeah.
That's all I'm saying is
yeah.
It should say something about you'd be required to enroll them in another school or submit.
Yes.
You don't have to homeschool them.
Oh, so I totally missed that. But yeah.
Well, but I guess if you're enrolling him in another school, then this policy doesn't really even apply. It's not like an absence anymore. It's like you move, then you move back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I guess that's just the way I look at it.
Because some people do that for a semester or whatever.
It's ambiguous. I mean, we were in this situation
right.
Where our children weren't, they were sort of exchange students.
Yeah.
But they went to school every day. You know, it's,
yeah.
It can be ambiguous sometimes. Mm. So I think it's good to spell it out because I think parents always know
the
language.
What they're supposed to do. Okay, great. Thank you, Kip, and the policy subcommittee doing great work. I really appreciate it.
Well, kudos to Kristen and Elaine and Deb.
Great. Okay, moving on to calendar of upcoming meetings. So at the next meeting, which is February 28th, we actually vote on the final budget. And it looks like we'll be ready to have an analysis of administrative costs
mm-hmm.
and teacher evaluation.
Yeah.
Preliminary information on that. Any things? Yes.
A question about the teacher evaluation.
Mm-hmm.
At our elementary school meeting the other night, Joan brought out this, incredible stack
mm-hmm.
of papers.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be a good idea to bring that stack
to
the meeting
sure.
so that people can see
sure.
the paperwork involved in this because it's really truly onerous.
Yeah.
And it's a good idea going back.
Yeah. I brought it to, if I may, I brought it to, you know, the stack to Pelham the other night in case we were going to talk about teacher evaluation. But I will bring the stack. And there's the potential for it to be very burdensome. However, there's also the potential to be very strategic about how you use supervision and evaluation to leverage improvement. And I think we have set ourselves up for, with collaborative teams, to be able to really think about team goal setting and showing progress in teams of their work, which will help us within the system. And also we are exploring, which we can talk more about by that point, different systems such as web-based programs like My Learning Plan. Which is a system that tracks the process of professional development. It is a request, an approval process for professional development and accrual of professional development points for relicensure, but it also has another component of teacher evaluation so that it will take the forms and you can have them put those forms within this process, which then helps you do walkthroughs the documentation of rubrics. It also helps you to manage timelines, where I could print out and say, show me where X principal is in their timeline of completing the. So it is a lot of work, but we're looking at tools that can help us become more efficient and be more effective in this process. So I'm not being too frightened yet.
I know we'll discuss this the next time, but if you could also clarify, initially when this first came out, the way I read the regs was that veteran teachers would not need to be evaluated every year. Now I'm hearing that they do have to be evaluated every year. Is that correct?
We will definitely clarify. My understanding at this moment, again, scratching the surface, is that in the initial round, you have to say 50% of our staff will be evaluated regardless of their professional teaching status. In the next cycle, anyone who has proficient or exemplary can then go on to a different cycle. So, but again, that's very cursory, general information. What I plan to do for the committee is to have Beth and Kathy Mazur, who are owning this part of the world for implementation, to come and talk with us about that information. So we'll make sure that we do address those specific points.
That's the third interpretation.
There you go. And it's interesting because by September we have to have this up and running.
Debbie.
Two thoughts. One, would it be okay if we had the 28th as a joint Pelham region meeting so that Maria does not have to repeat everything on the 28th again?
I'd love that.
March 1st.
It's okay with me.
Okay, so we can just post it that way. And then my second thought is, as I look, and I hesitate to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway, as I look toward March and April, can we think about maybe in the later spring, summer months, not doing two meetings a month, and maybe combining these into one meeting per month? I mean, I understand during the fall and during budget season, it makes a lot of sense, but I'm not sure we need it year-round.
Yeah. I think that'd be great. Mm-hmm. And we also will look at this calendar more. I mean, we have some things slated out, but we will, as topics come up that people really want us to address, we'll make sure that we fill in those topics.
Catherine?
Yeah, on that note, I was wondering, I don't see it here, and I've been to the late start forums, two of the three late start forums, and in my case talked about sometime in late March coming in. So I was just wondering if you had some thought about when that might be.
Yeah,
when we'll discuss it again.
We didn't update that. I apologize. So I'll make sure I add that. It would be, I need to speak with Mike, but most likely we'll have to do probably the last meeting in March, which would be the 27th. Mm-hmm. I think that allows us enough time to really do the work. If he's ready to come forward on the 13th, that's fine as well.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. If there's nothing else, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Beautiful.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you all. Thank you.